All right, welcome. This is a sort of a 101 on key design considerations for your cloud storage. For my European friends in the audience, that four at the bottom there, that's the month. Yeah. Talking to you, Dan. All right, so I'm Mike Tutkowski. I'm a developer at SolidFire, but I'm working on CloudStack full-time, also on the CloudStack PMC. So mainly I'm focused, because SolidFire is in the data storage industry, mainly I'm focused on CloudStack's primary storage component for the time being. Doing a lot of work around SolidFire's main feature sets. The company, so SolidFire, we're based out of Boulder, Colorado, so this is right in our backyard. We're only about 30, 35 miles away from here. The system that we work on is a clustered scale-out technology that's designed from the ground up to support hard quality of service guarantees. So what this means in practicality is the ability to be able to set on a volume by volume basis a minimum guaranteed performance, a maximum number of IOPS as well, and what we call a burst number of IOPS. So the whole idea here is to be able to bring performance consistency to a shared infrastructure in the cloud. So taking away the uncertainty when end users run applications in the cloud, and maybe one day the cloud is heavily utilized and they're seeing great performance, but the next day there's a whole lot of activity going on in the cloud and their performance is somewhat lackluster. So SolidFire's goal is to be able to bring essentially like the concept of dedicated storage, but in a shared, the performance consistency of dedicated storage, but in a shared infrastructure, performance consistency. So I won't go into too much detail here with just having 30 minutes, but it's an all SSD system, in leverages inline compression, deduplication, to bring the cost of the SAN on par with traditional disk-based systems. And the part I will mention at the way bottom is the concept of a comprehensive REST-like API, which as I get into the presentation here, we'll see how important such a concept is in a cloud environment where everything has to be automated. It's ideal if you can take the human factor out of everything and just automate from the moment an end user kicks off a VM to provisioning a volume down to a guaranteed number of IOPS. So let's move on here. And just at a high level, kind of just look at some of the points that we'll go into over the next 25 minutes. So supporting multiple workloads, I think, is one of the big areas in cloud storage to look at. You don't really know in a cloud environment what the different tenants are going to be up to on a day-to-day basis. Some of them, and you don't know what kind of workloads they're running. At a very high level, CloudStack is broken up into secondary storage, which is more for your ISOs, your backups, your templates, a lot of write once, read many, sequential kind of operations. And then at the lower level, we're looking at primary storage, which is, as a lot of you probably know, storage for your root and your data disks, a lot of random access kind of activity. So we'll go into detail on that, dive a little bit more, especially into the primary storage area. Designing for scale is another area to look at, and we'll cover that to some extent as well. Everything is easy when it's a small system. You don't really notice much of a management burden until you start scaling out your cloud, or in this case, specifically referring to your cloud storage. So what we want to make sure is that as your cloud grows over time, as your storage needs increase, that you're able to maintain that management simplicity even when the number of petabytes or IOPS are adding up in your cloud environment. Protecting data, so we'll cover this a little bit as well. So not all data is gonna be created equally. Some of the data, maybe it can be rebuilt from some source, and it's not really necessary to take extreme measures to protect it. In other cases, maybe you want two or even three copies of the data. One of the things we'll kind of chat about a little bit is not surfacing so much the details, the technical details to the end user of how the data is being protected. Maybe talking about it more in terms of what really matter to the end user. So how many faults can your VM tolerate versus focusing so much on, yeah, this is RAID 5, you know, it's parity encoded versus mirrored or something like that. So really trying to tease out of the end user what they really need the system to do, what the requirements are, and then translating that through some abstraction layer, which CloudStack does a nice job of providing, into the actual technical implementation. And bottom point, just kind of discussed it a moment ago, so managing the cloud storage and just understanding the importance of a comprehensive API that you can have CloudStack plug into through one of its, either if it's a storage plugin or in your case, if you could be building other kinds of plugins, but whatever system you're dealing with, it needs to have a very comprehensive API so that everything can be automated. All right, so this slide is really just kind of meant to impress upon you the various types of workloads that you might see in your cloud. Some of you might have more than this or less or different kinds of workloads, but the guy on the left, he's really just representative of your storage system. He's balancing all of your different requirements and they're taking him in different conflicting directions. And we just need to have some way of making sure that our cloud can deal with those conflicting, in this case, conflicting storage requirements and make sure it's a smooth experience for the end user in the end, pretty much transparent to the end user of all of these complexities that are going on. All right, so probably agree that if you have a dozen or so workloads, you don't want to have a dozen or so different storage systems, one tailored to each of those particular workloads. So, you know, it would be too costly. It's very complex to manage that. In a sense, if you have a million different vendors, it could be a million different islands of storage. It increases your management complexity. And so we want to kind of tease out the common attributes that are necessary for your storage system. Again, I mentioned this earlier. For CloudStack, at a very high level, it divides storage into primary and secondary storage. So that's one way of just approaching the problem in the beginning, is just understanding, am I trying to solve a secondary storage problem around ISOs, templates, backups? That might be one category of storage system. Or am I looking to solve more primary storage-oriented issues around random access for root disks, data disks? And trying to understand, I guess, what kind of performance and capacity, I guess, requirements you have for your particular cloud in that particular environment. So we'll get into this again as I proceed, but just wanted to kind of point it out at the time being. And I also wanted to kind of note that bottom point is that traditionally the way these problems have gone about being solved is through using some kind of a tiering scheme. So you could look even in CloudStack at primary versus secondary as at a high level. That's a tiering scheme. But even in the primary storage area, there's going to be different, a whole bunch of different workloads that you can run in primary storage. And again, traditionally, people have gone about putting big buckets big tiering buckets in place. So maybe fast tier, medium tier, kind of a slower, basic kind of tier. And then running their applications in these tiers depending on their needs. One of the things I kind of wanted to point out there was that may be okay for a mid-sized enterprise if you have an understanding, a very detailed understanding of the kind of workloads that are running in your environment, then you may be able to take that paradigm and actually make it work. However, it kind of breaks down as you get into cloud scale and enterprise scale in that you don't really know in a cloud environment what your tenants are doing. Or as a tenant yourself, you know you have neighbors, but you don't know what they're doing. And you don't know if they're going to be impacting you from day to day. So as a cloud service provider or a large enterprise, it's really hard to understand, I'm going to put this tenant in the gold tier, the silver tier. And one of the alternatives I wanted to kind of chat about was being able to have a tier for every single volume or every single application you have on the storage system. So this is kind of where I put in a little plug for my storage plugin. One of the abilities it gives you for SolidFire is to be able to guarantee on a volume by volume basis a number of IOPS, a minimum and a maximum and a burst number of IOPS, which scales much, much nicer in a cloud environment. It enables you as a tenant to not have to worry about what your neighbors are doing. It's almost like you're on a dedicated system, but you have the shared economics of a large cloud environment. So I'll talk about that as I kind of go on, but traditionally, I'm gonna look at traditional tiering here to begin with and just kind of contrast it with how CloudStack works. So typically what would happen here is, like I said, you might have like three tiers. Each of these tiers was often in the past tied into a specific hardware vendor. So you might have vendor A in tier one. It has perhaps a really good data protection feature, and you weren't too shy maybe about advertising that directly to your end users, allowing them to directly leverage that feature, which is fine until the time comes to actually maybe swap out that vendor or add another vendor into the same tier, ideally, but that vendor may not have the same exact feature set, and now you're kind of in this weird conundrum. CloudStack does a great job of addressing this through just the concept of service descriptions, what they call compute offerings, disk offerings. It's a really nice way of abstracting the technology from what the actual business requirements are. So with a compute offering, many of you are probably familiar with this, you can specify number of virtual CPUs, the amount of memory, what kind of capacity you need for your storage, and now with the advent of the SolidFire plugin, you can even specify a minimum and a maximum number of IOPS on a volume by volume basis. So the great point there too is you don't have to completely expose the underlying technology to the end user. You can really get at their needs better through this concept of compute offerings and disk offerings. One of the ways that CloudStack has traditionally done this and made it somewhat vendor neutral is through the concept of storage tagging. So a compute offering can list some of its needs in the storage tags field, which is just like a comma separated list of values. It might be as simple as saying for storage tagging, I need fast storage versus maybe medium or slow. And then in the primary storage area of CloudStack, each of those primary storages has its own storage tagging, ways of describing itself. I'm fast storage, or it could be very specific, I'm SolidFire storage. But if you keep it generic enough, you're in this ability, you have this flexibility where you can take in additional storage in the future, add it to CloudStack as primary storage, tag it as, say, fast storage, and now you don't actually have to modify your compute offerings or your disk offerings. If they said they wanted to use fast storage, they can now take advantage of this new storage that you added. You could even mix and match vendors that way if that was something ideal for your particular situation. So kind of just wanted to distinguish the one from the other as we move forward, and just point out that CloudStack does a really good job of that with compute offerings and disk offerings. It's a really nice way to kind of keep yourself neutral as possible from the underlying technology, especially from the end user's perspective, not exposing to them all of those details like parity encoding and all sorts of things like that, RAID groups. So kind of talked about this just a little while ago, why build around service descriptions. The main idea is to try to keep some kind of infrastructure flexibility in place and not tie yourself too closely to the underlying technology. Really, I think VMware has a product, vSAN. I'm not sure if it's out on the market yet, but I was looking through their GUI the other day, and they did a great job of actually not asking for low-level details like do you want this parity encoded when it came to protecting your data, but rather asking at a VM level, what kind of fault tolerance do you need here? If this goes offline, is that okay, or do we actually have to make sure that that maintains some kind of constant availability? So really just looking at it from an end user's point of view, what do you really want versus how am I gonna implement that technically? Let's see. Okay, got about 15 minutes. So maybe we talked about this a little bit, but also we're gonna look at some of these scale issues, like how does the storage system scale? What are your storage needs in your environment, and how do you translate that into a particular storage vendor? So one of the areas that I think is the most important to point out here is the concept of scale-out storage versus scale-up storage. So I'm not sure how familiar that term is to people, but scale-out is typically associated with a clustered architecture where you start with a certain number of storage nodes. They are relatively independent nodes. So if I use SolidFire as an example, you might start a system with 5 storage nodes, maybe 50 terabytes of data. And then as you need to, you add on additional storage nodes, each having their own processing and storage capabilities, versus the more traditional approach of scale up, which is typically a couple controller heads fronting some disk shelves. And the way you tend to scale out that kind of a system is by adding additional disks to the disk shelf until you kind of reach the processing point, like the breaking point of the controllers. And at that point, you're kind of left with a decision. Maybe you can upgrade those controllers, or if you're already kind of at the maximum controller capabilities, you might have to do a complete rip and replace migration. So one of the things to definitely take a look into if you're looking to build out cloud storage is the concept of scale out versus scale up. That's kind of the gist of that. So some of the areas here we'll also take a look at is just sort of like computing and networking resource limits and data center footprint in general. Just in that case, how green is your storage? Is it powering spinning disks that aren't going to be used for years and years? I'm gonna smile now for the picture. There you go. Is it powering spinning disks that aren't gonna be used for years and years? Like some of the larger vendors might come in, they might drop off a huge amount of storage, a more monolithic type architecture, where you have a lot of storage, but you're probably not gonna use it for many years. And in the meanwhile, it's consuming space, it requires to be powered and cooled in the meanwhile, it's very expensive. So a lot of those considerations are really worth taking into consideration. There's a lot of good options in terms of greener storage these days that can really lead to a lot of cost savings. So just wanted to point that out as something to definitely give some consideration to. All right, so just diving a little bit deeper into designing for scale. There's at least a couple ways of approaching this. The one on the left is probably, if you're mainly cloud service providers and large enterprises, that may not be the ideal approach. In that case, it's more focused on, say, like data analytics, where the more data you have, the more processing power you need. So there's really a direct one-to-one mapping there. The more you have of the one, the more you need of the other. What we're really looking at here, being that this is a CloudStack collaboration conference, is infrastructure as a service. And in this environment, your relationship between compute and storage is more loosely coupled. You don't really know as a service provider if you get a lot more tenants on your cloud. Does that mean you need a lot, directly proportional amount of compute power, or just because there's a lot more data on the SAN? Or does that not maybe equate to being the same thing? So what you really want, and I think what CloudStack does a great job of doing, is allowing you to kind of break these into two separately scalable components. So you have the ability for your compute cluster to, in CloudStack, you can add on additional compute nodes into the same cluster. You can add additional clusters. They can be of different hypervisor types to suit whatever needs you have. So you can really scale that out completely independent from your storage system, regardless of the type of storage system that you have. So just kind of wanted to point out the difference there. So you might be in an environment where it actually does make sense. Those two do go hand in hand. Or for infrastructure as a service, it's probably more likely you're going to be in a more loosely coupled environment where one does not necessarily equate to increasing the other in parallel. So let's move on for time here. I think I got about 10 minutes. So sizing the storage system, I talked a little bit about this. At a very basic level, there's monolithic type storage systems, bring in a whole bunch of storage at one time, drop it off in your data center. And then you have a lot of storage that may or may not be used for years and years to come, versus either a clustered kind of an architecture, which is what I was referring to earlier as a scale-out architecture, which is the concept really of bringing in just kind of what you need for now and the foreseeable future, and then growing it out over time, so sort of paying as you grow, which also saves not just the money in having to buy the storage up front, but also not needing to cool and power that kind of those kind of devices when you're not actually using them. And even in a scale, it's not really a clustered architecture, but a scale-up situation, you still have the somewhat benefit of not necessarily needing to fill all the disk shelves at once. You can build that out over time. So there's a few different things to look at there. Do you really want a monolithic system? Do you want something more of like a scale-out architecture or a scale-up? At least three options there. All right, so I'm going to go a little bit faster through this area here just for sake of time. Obviously, we're going to need to take into consideration how many virtual machines we're running in a cluster, what the hypervisor in question can handle. But more from a storage-focused standpoint, taking a look at the LUN limits is a good idea in any storage environment. So one of the areas I was just discussing this with somebody from Citrix yesterday was LUN limits for Zen Server, which is currently around 256 LUNs per host. And that may not sound like a lot with the way people have traditionally used CloudStack. Traditionally, what people were doing was if it was Zen Server, the admin would go off, he'd allocate a storage repository. This would be sort of a manual process, introduce the storage repository into CloudStack as primary storage. And then from that point going forward, CloudStack would deploy a whole bunch of root disks and data disks on the same storage volume, and they would share that volume. So even if the volume itself, even if let's say this is a SolidFire volume and it has guaranteed IOPS, those root and data disks are like mini tenants on that volume, and internally within the volume, they compete for IOPS, which is not a great situation for quality of service. So one of the things I've been working on over the last year or so is bringing true quality of service to CloudStack's various hypervisor types. And for example, for Zen Server, one of the ways this is done is by actually dynamically creating a storage repository. So as an example, a user spins up a virtual machine, the virtual machine needs a root disk. The root disk is going to lead to the creation on the fly of a SolidFire volume with a minimum number of IOPS. Once that's accomplished, CloudStack can then orchestrate Zen Server to create a storage repository and then a virtual disk image within the storage repository that is essentially that SolidFire volume. So in this case, you actually have a one-to-one relationship between your SolidFire volume, or just keeping it more generic, whatever volume you have on the back end, and the disk that's actually in your VM, whether it's a root disk or a data disk. So you have the direct mapping. If you have a certain number of IOPS for that SAN volume, it directly equates to a certain number of IOPS for that root disk or the data disk. But that does explode the number of LUNs. So I've been working with guys from Citrix on ways to either ease this LUN limit, which it sounds like there's a very good possibility with 64-bit Zen that they're going to be able to bump that number up quite a bit, or there's a number of other techniques I'm looking into implementing. But it is something to take into consideration. Again, for the sake of time, I'm going to skip through the the next line here, which is VLAN limits, but that's something to take into consideration as well. Data center footprint, I kind of discussed it a bit earlier. Monolithic system take up tons of space in your data center versus maybe getting a whole bunch of IOPS and capacity in a couple U. That's, it's not just, doesn't just look prettier, but it also is much greener in terms of, and that saves, you know, saves you costs for electricity, for powering the devices. So that's something, even just in terms of simplicity of cabling such a system. The one thing, now I've been at SolidFire for about a year and a half, the one thing I remember from early on was a picture of a previous vendor that we had replaced. And the thing that caught my eye the most was just the huge complexity of the previous implementation in terms of all of the cabling, which sometimes that just sort of seems aesthetic, but it's very easy to make mistakes when you have tons and tons of cables. If you have a storage system, or any kind of a system, rather, that is just simpler, it makes things so much more reliable in terms of not having human error get in the way of things. Let's see. I'm going to have to maybe move through this data protection option slide a little bit faster than I expected. The idea here is there's a few different options for protecting your data. Third-party tools, hypervisor snapshots, vendor-specific snapshots. So at the very top, we've got the third-party tools. One of the examples might be, well, I guess, I don't know if I should say Microsoft here, because it's Cloud Stack Conference, but Microsoft Volume Shadow Copy Service, VSS. So that's a third-party tool which is used in concert with applications that implement this functionality to allow the applications to be aware of the fact that we'd like to take a snapshot of the disks that they're using. And then they can get to a really well-quiesced state, and at that point we can either take a hypervisor snapshot or take a back-end SAN snapshot. But the idea there is you actually have the data in a consistent state. You weren't halfway through a transaction when you took a snapshot. If you have multiple disks for a particular application, they can all be taken at the same point in time, and you don't have to worry about restoring that, trying to restore that state and being surprised. Because that's one of the things, too, I think that ends up happening is that people take snapshots, they do a good job of taking snapshots, but they don't always test restoring from those snapshots and seeing if it actually worked the way you expected. I mean, just because the snapshot was taken doesn't necessarily mean, depending on the technology that you used, that it was taken in a state that can be easily recovered to. So especially if your application is using multiple disks, if transactions are in flight when you're taking snapshots. So a tool like VSS, for example, or other products can really help out in that regard. One of the cons there is it's just another product to manage. I know on a previous system I worked on, a previous SAN, we had some software installed on each of the hosts, and we would send commands to that software to tell it, to tell VSS, to quiesce the application, and then take a snapshot. And well, it worked great. You know, it was a little bit difficult on the con side to upgrade when people had dozens or hundreds of hosts. Unless you have some way to upgrade that snapshotting software, that third-party software, in a really efficient way, it can be difficult to maintain that. So that just kind of gets around to automation again, trying to automate everything. I'll cover these other two pretty quickly. So hypervisor snapshots is definitely an option. It's kind of a interesting situation there where you take a snapshot, take a hypervisor snapshot. Kind of depends on how the application that's being run within that virtual machine was written. It may or may not end up having flushed everything to disk before you took that hypervisor snapshot. So if you snapshot the memory along with the disks, you're fine. If you shut the virtual machine down, of course, you're fine. Then that's naturally quiesced. But if it is running, again, this is one of these situations. Test it. Take your snapshots. Restore them. And see if it actually behaves the way you expected. The final one there is just vendor-side snapshots. This has the very big plus of being the fastest option of the three. I know, for example, for the solid fire sand, taking a clone, it's really just a metadata copy. So it consumes no extra block space on the system. So there's that space savings, and it's also incredibly fast. Now, if application consistency is a big concern, you're going to want to tie that in somehow through either a third-party tool or maybe even through CloudStack, through some kind of hypervisor. I believe my NetApp friends did a nice plug-in one, you know, with doing Quiesce snapshots with hypervisors. So there's a lot of different options in play in terms of back-end storage and how efficient it can be, but also think through how that relates to application consistency. And again, just test it. Make sure it actually works. All right, so I'm going to wrap it up here. The big point here that I kind of want to get to was automation at every step of the way. A lot of that is really highly dependent on the storage system that you use. Not all systems, don't assume that the storage system that you're looking at necessarily has a comprehensive API. Actually investigate that and make sure that it can do everything that you need it to do. Sometimes, I know when I worked on a mid-range SAN, well, the API was great, but it was incredibly proprietary. It was great for me as a developer, but for third parties, it was not a great API. It was never intended to be, because in the mid-range business, most people either used a GUI or they used a CLI. They didn't have a ton of automation. They didn't really have a lot of needs for automation. But in a cloud environment, you always have a need for automation at every step of the way. So just make sure that the API for the storage system that you're using actually is very comprehensive and easy to use. Let's just go down to leveraging tools at the bottom. I was just talking to a customer the other day. Actually, I was at ApacheCon on Monday. And they asked a great question, which a lot of people don't ask. They know that, well, SolidFire, we are CloudStack compatible. But their question was, what does that really mean? So I went through and explained, because they're completely right. It doesn't take much to say that you're compatible, for example, with CloudStack. You can just be iSCSI storage, for example, and just by implementing that protocol, in a sense, you are compatible with CloudStack. But their question was really good. They wanted me to go into detail how many of SolidFire's features, which is what really drove them to purchase the SAN, can be leveraged and done so easily through CloudStack. And so I encourage everybody to really think about those things too. Just because somebody says that they're compatible with a particular stack, like CloudStack, doesn't necessarily mean it's going to meet your needs. So definitely follow through with that. Let's see, I'm a couple minutes over here. Okay, this is just sort of wrap-up material. So as we talked about before, we really want to have the ability to adjust the underlying infrastructure without changing service expectations. CloudStack does a great job of that with storage tagging. We're improving upon that as the releases go on. Granular scaling, both in terms of your storage system and CloudStack's compute capabilities. Rack density, really that's around green storage and the cost savings you can glean from that. Let's see, independent data protection, we talked about that, and obviously I've kind of beat to death fully automating everything. So basically just don't compromise your goals, stick to what the users need, and really try to get out of them the requirements that they need rather than how you might technically implement that. So I'm a couple minutes over. I don't know if I really have any time for questions, but anybody can grab me. I'm generally over at the SolidFire booth today, so thanks a lot for listening.